So welcome to Amherst. I hope you all have a terrific and healthy and happy reunion. So this John Demjanjuk, this born Ivan Demjanjuk, as you heard, he spent most of his adult life as a machinist at Ford in Cleveland. In fact, I'm sure the name is probably familiar to at least some of you. And this Ford machinist, he also happened to be the subject of, as we also heard, the lengthiest and arguably the most bizarre criminal case to emerge out of the crimes of the Holocaust. All told, Demjanjuk was tried 4 separate times. He was tried twice in the United States on civil immigration charges, that is, for having lied on his immigration forms, earning the dubious distinction of being the only person in American history to be twice stripped of his citizenship. He was tried once in Israel as Ivan the Terrible of Treblinka, a particularly notorious death camp guard, and he was actually sentenced to death, only to have his sentence tossed out when the Israelis realized they got the wrong Ivan. And this has to go down as one of the most famous cases of mistaken identity in the history of law. And then he was finally tried a couple decades later, 2009 through 2011, in Munich. And in Munich, he was tried not as Ivan the Terrible, but, and I kind of mean this a little facetiously, but we can say he was kind of tried as Ivan the Not-So-Hot. Because it turned out that even though he had not been a death camp guard at Treblinka, it turned out that he had been a death camp guard at Sobibor, an equally lethal Nazi death camp. So, in writing about this case, I suppose I tried to do 3 things, which have been actually kind of nicely summarized already. On some level, I was trying to do justice to a very kind of complex and interesting narrative, so I just want to tell this story well of this 35-year-long legal struggle. As a second matter, I was interested in using this case as a conduit for looking at the larger history of criminal trials involving the Holocaust, and specifically kind of using this case as an opportunity to look at the way 3 separate domestic national legal systems, the American, the Israeli, and the German, all tried to struggle with the question, the legal issues that were raised by the perpetrator and the collaborator in Nazi crimes. And then as a third matter, I can say that I tried to use this case as an opportunity to offer a pretty robust defense of what took place in Germany in 2009 to 2011, that he was convicted in 2011. There was a lot of skepticism about the wisdom of trying him that time. In fact, when I first arrived in the Munich courtroom writing about this case for Harper's Magazine, I have to say that, I mean, my own personal predilections stray in the direction of the grotesque. And I kind of was wondering, what on earth was Germany doing trying this guy who's basically 90 years old at the time of the trial for crimes that took place 70 years earlier? And I really wondered what legal good was going to come out of the trial. And to my own kind of surprise, I ended up becoming very convinced of the importance of really the kind of historical importance of what that German court did. And I'll try perhaps to give you a quick thumbnail sketch of why I believe that was an important trial. So those are the 3 things I was trying to do with the book. Let me just kind of then step back, and I'll probably talk for about half an hour or so and then leave, I hope, some time for your questions. Let me now step back and kind of give you a little bit more detail about the backstory, the kind of the strange story of the case. So Demjanjuk, he was born as Ivan in the Ukraine in 1920. In 1941, I should say, he was drafted into the Soviet Red Army on the wake of the German invasion of the Soviet Union. In 1942, he was taken by the German army as a prisoner of war. This was in the spring of 1942. And Demjanjuk's story, the story that he kept to from the first time that legal authorities became aware of him until the end of his life, he always maintained, I remained a prisoner of war of the Germans. From 1942, basically until the war's end, I was a POW. That was the story that he always held onto. If we jump to after the war, right after the war, he basically bounces around a number of displaced persons camps that were run by the US Army. In 1952, he's finally able to secure a visa to come with his wife and then a first child to the United States. He ends up becoming a naturalized US citizen in 1958. And on this very day that he becomes a naturalized US citizen, he also officially changes his name from Ivan to John. And he ends up basically raising a family in suburban Cleveland. And in working for Ford in the mid-century, I mean, we have to remember, you know, this is a time in which being a unionized UAW worker working at Ford really kind of permitted a transition to a comfortable middle-class lifestyle. And he lived in a kind of nice middle-class suburb of Cleveland. And there he remained up until the mid-70s. And in the mid-70s, American investigators, through kind of very circuitous routes, they received information that this Ford machinist might have engaged in unsavory activities during the war, that is, after he was taken a prisoner by the Wehrmacht. And the key piece of evidence that the Americans received was a copy of an identity card of Demjanjuk's from something called the Treniki camp. The Treniki camp was an SS training camp. And what the SS training camp did is it basically, the SS combed through Soviet prisoner of war camps, that is, German prisoner of war camps that captured Soviet soldiers. They combed through these camps looking for people who they thought would be useful collaborators in basically exterminatory practices. And in combing through these POW camps, they basically identified about 5,000 largely Ukrainians, not exclusively Ukrainians, some of them were Latvians, some Lithuanians, some Estonians, largely Ukrainians. And they plucked these guys out of the POW camp and sent them to a very different camp. And this was this Treniki camp, which was, again, this SS training camp. And this is his ID from the SS training camp. And the photograph is unmistakably of a younger Demjanjuk. In fact, he's never denied that that was a photograph of him, even though he always tried to deny that this card, which ultimately came to the Americans from the Soviets, was a KGB forgery. But so this is this was a document that American investigators got. And the American investigators noticed that he had been, after he had trained at this Treniki camp, he had been assigned as a guard to the Sobibor death camp. So these American investigators, they weren't actually interested in bringing criminal charges against Demjanjuk for the very simple reason that they could not do so. These were, after all, crimes that had taken place in Europe against other Europeans at a time when Demjanjuk was also a citizen of a different country. And so just as a kind of narrow jurisdictional matter, the Americans had no jurisdiction over the case to press criminal charges. But the one kind of arrow that was in the quiver of American prosecutors was that they could bring civil immigration charges against him. Because needless to say, when he filled out his immigration forms, he didn't mention collaborating with the SS at a death camp as one of the things that he had participated in the mid-1940s. So in preparing the case against Demjanjuk, the American prosecutors, they turned to Israeli police for help. And the reason they turned to the Israeli police for help is because most of the survivors of Sobibor, of which there were very few on the planet to begin with, most of them resided in Israel, and they thought the Israelis could help in identifying Demjanjuk as having served as a guard at Sobibor. So the Israelis engaged in, you know, something that's very familiar to us from police dramas. They compiled a identification parade. They basically, they arranged a bunch of photographs on a spreadsheet, and they called in various Sobibor survivors to identify the photographs. Now, the Israelis just happened to be also investigating a Treblinka guard. It just completely coincidental. They were also investigating a guard who was alleged to be at Treblinka, and they just, for the purposes of cutting corners, of just kind of being efficient, they used the same photo spread. So they basically had a picture of this Treblinka guard next to the picture of Demjanjuk, the alleged Sobibor guard, and they basically just kind of used the same photo spread. And to their disappointment, the Sobibor survivors come in and they go, yeah, I can't really identify any of the people in this photograph, in these photographs, sorry. So they're a little disappointed. And before they communicate their disappointment back to the Americans, they're continuing this completely unrelated Treblinka investigation. And the Treblinka survivors start like looking over the photographs and they go, ooh, well, I recognize that guy. Ooh, I recognize him. This is the guy that we knew as Ivan Grozny, or Ivan the Terrible. And this Ivan the Terrible was a really notorious guard at Treblinka. If you go back, for example, and look at the transcripts from the famous Eichmann trial that took place in Jerusalem in 1961, you have a number of Treblinka survivors at that trial already testifying about the legendary sadism and cruelty of this guard that they refer to as Ivan the Terrible. And so the Israeli investigators at first, when they start pointing out to when she has a number of these Treblinka survivors identifying Demjanjuk as Ivan the Terrible, she goes, no, you got it all wrong. He was at Sobibor. He was not at Treblinka. And the survivors are like, now wait a second. It's not like I was like hit by a car and caught a fleeting glance of the guy who was driving off. I saw this guy day in and day out for months on end, and his image is like burned in my retina. I know that this guy was Ivan the Terrible. And so finally, the Israelis go back to the Americans and they say, you found not just some like any old death camp guard, you found a really baddie. And so the Americans at the time, again, this was in the mid-1980s, it was by far the most highly publicized denaturalization case in American history. They basically denaturalized Demjanjuk as Ivan the Terrible of Treblinka. He is sent to Israel, and he is he's tried there. And I just wanted to, this attractive volume, Price to Move, I wanted to actually maybe just read you just very briefly from Demjanjuk's appearance on the stand, because when he was tried in Israel, he did testify on his own behalf, which is, we all know from watching police drama, is a very dicey thing for a defendant to do, but he did testify on his own behalf. Demjanjuk began his testimony 5 months into the trial, and his 7 days facing his judges doomed him as much as the evidence submitted by the prosecution. A boisterous courtroom audience repeatedly greeted his testimony with jeers of derision. When a Hebrew interpreter misinterpreted Demjanjuk's utterance that in 1941 he had been 82 yards tall, spectators assumed the defendant was mocking the court and exploded in shouts of outrage and demanding his death. More generally, Demjanjuk's testimony offered a textbook illustration of a simple but elusive truth. If you intend to lie about your past, it's important to get the story straight from the outset. By the time that he took the stand in Jerusalem, Demjanjuk had made numerous statements to American officials over the years, creating a paper trail rich in contradiction. Read in chronological order, his statements suggest that the speaker suffered from a disease new to the annals of neurology, reverse dementia. Facts, items, and events left maddeningly vague in earlier statements or omitted altogether gradually take form over time, grow sharp, and crystallize in later testimony. For example, in his first deposition with lawyers from the Justice Department in 1978, Demjanjuk reported that after his capture by the Wehrmacht, he was taken to a POW camp in Rovno, where he slept in a railroad car and was put to work altering the gauge of rail tracks. He spoke of a second camp, though he could not recall its whereabouts. I forget. 3 years later, he recalled the site of the second POW camp as Helm. His task in this camp, he said, was to build barracks. Some changes, expansions, and emendations in Demjanjuk's testimony could perhaps be overlooked, but not Helm. Helm was his alibi. By his own admission, Demjanjuk had spent only a few weeks at Rovno, probably no more than three. By contrast, he claimed to have been at Helm for at least 18 months, that is, during the entire period of his alleged training at Treniki and his service as a death camp guard. When pressed by Israeli prosecutors to account for having forgotten Helm at his first deposition, Demjanjuk could provide no answer. "Mr. Prosecutor, what do you want from a person who had only 4 years of schooling? I forgot. I can't say why I forgot. I forgot." So, in part as a result of this kind of less than stellar appearance on his own behalf on the witness stand, and also almost entirely as a result of the testimony of the survivor witnesses who swore with absolute certainty to recognize in Demjanjuk their former tormentor, he was convicted and sentenced to death. The appellate phase of the case just happened to coincide, fortuitously coincided, with the unraveling of the Soviet Union. And that was extremely helpful for Demjanjuk. Actually, we can even say it was helpful for the Israeli justice system as well. Because what this meant is that suddenly documents, and we're not talking about like hundreds of pages or thousands of pages, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of pages of documents that had been moldering in KGB files, suddenly became available to both the defense team and the Israeli prosecutors. And what this material revealed, and revealed beyond a doubt, was the Israelis had the wrong guy. That this Ivan the Terrible had in fact been a completely different Ukrainian guard named Ivan Marchenko. If you look at the photographs of Marchenko and compare them to Demjanjuk, is there a slight and maybe not even kind of entirely negligible resemblance? The answer is yes, they do look a bit alike. But it really made very, very clear that Demjanjuk was not Ivan the Terrible. At the same time, this material, these hundreds of thousands of pages of documents, they made clear what the American investigators had kind of thought from the outset. It made very clear that this guy had been at Sobibor. And the Israelis then had this very difficult problem. They like, well, we didn't try him as Ivan the Not-So-Hot of Sobibor. We tried him as Ivan the Terrible of Treblinka. And what do we do? And one of the things that led the Israelis, I think, ultimately to just toss out the conviction and decide not to try retrying him is that around this time, the Justice Department, through a Freedom of Information Act request, has to release what is the classic smoking gun kind of memorandum. There is a lawyer within the Justice Department who, even before the denaturalization proceeding, writes a memo to the other people in the Department of Justice saying, "I really don't think this guy's Ivan the Terrible. I really think we got the wrong guy here." And so the Israelis realized that the Americans had these doubts even before the extradition to Israel. And so they are now apoplectic with the American prosecutors that they never shared these doubts with them. And so they basically say, enough. We're sending him back to the United States. He's your problem now. And so he comes back to the United States in a completely bizarre thing. He gets his citizenship back. And then the people in the Department of Justice are like, well, notwithstanding the fact that we might have screwed up in this first case, he still was a guard at Sobibor. And so they basically start up these denaturalization and deportation proceedings up for a second time. He gets denaturalized again. At this point, the American authorities start looking around to find a country that would accept him, and they have a hard time doing. Ukraine says nope, Poland says nope. Germany, for a long time, had been very, very reluctant to accept Nazi collaborators back into their country. And perhaps in the Q&A, I could explain why that was the case. And rather surprisingly, Germany in 2009 agrees to accept Demjanjuk back into to Germany for the purposes of trying him. So in 2009, he is put on trial in Munich. And again, I'll just read very briefly what the atmosphere was like in the courtroom on the very first day of the Munich trial. the first day of trial. All at once, the chatter in Gerichtssaal 101, courtroom 101, dies down as a door at the side of the chamber swings open. Flanked by two medical orderlies and a court-appointed doctor, the defendant is maneuvered into the courtroom in a wheelchair. A sky blue blanket drawn all the way up to his chin covers his leg and body, and a blue baseball cap juts low over his brow. His eyes are closed, and it's unclear whether he's asleep or just fending off the explosion of camera flashes. Photographers, cameramen, videographers clamor in front of the wheelchair, shooting away in a frenzy, as if Gisele Bündchen had just sashayed into the Munich courtroom. Demjanjuk's mouth hangs open. He appears to mutter words or moan in pain. Cameras flash. A helpless octogenarian, wheelchair-bound, grimacing before a relentless onslaught of publicity. It is not a sight to burnish the criminal justice system's reputation. Demjanjuk's re-entry into the courtroom after the midday lunch only adds to the carnivalesque atmosphere. Gone is the wheelchair, replaced now by a monstrous orange ambulance gurney. Demjanjuk lies flat on his back, a white blanket drawn, so it appears from my vantage point, over his head. It seems that the defendant, during the lunch break, has died. A corpse has been wheeled in to stand trial. Cornelius Nessler, a professor of criminal law representing relatives of persons murdered at Sobibor, jumps to his feet. Nessler is keenly aware that the prosecution of Demjanjuk is more than a collision over evidence and law. It is a competition over images that would be transmitted around the world. "Excuse me," Nessler says, "I'd like to know why he's positioned like that." A team of three doctors briefly confers and announce that the defendant has said he's uncomfortable sitting. "Well, will it be possible," Nessler asks, "at least to raise him?" The picture this projects is most disconcerting. The court announces a recess to discuss the matter, and soon a Solomonic compromise is reached. The defendant may remain on the gurney, but propped up at a 45-degree angle. Maybe I'll stop that right there. The trial, which was originally supposed to last only 4 months, ended up dragging on for about 18 months. And the trial, nevertheless, to my mind, became a very important moment. And the importance of it was, I think we can kind of maybe identify the importance by comparing it very briefly to the Demjanjuk trial, the terrible trial in Israel. In Israel, Demjanjuk was really tried as a sociopath, as kind of a sadist. I mean, if you kind of even think about Hollywood's image of the SS guard or the collaborating Nazi genocide, this was exactly what Ivan the Terrible was like. You know, someone who kind of had these sociopathic tendencies. In Munich, the prosecution basically said, we don't know how he behaved personally while he was at Sobibor. We have no idea if he was cruel. We have no idea if he was sadistic. We have no idea if he was a sociopath. In fact, we're willing to stipulate to the fact that he wasn't. We're willing to agree that all he did was act as a guard at a death camp. But that, the argument of the prosecution was sufficient in order to convict him as an accessory to murder. Because one thing that the prosecution argued was that, again, it was a very simple argument, but it took a court 70 years, no American court, no Israeli court, basic courts in other countries never arrived at the simple conclusion that if you participated as a guard at a death camp, you were by definition an accessory to murder because that was your job, period. And so it became a very interesting moment in which the prosecution comes forward and says, again, we don't care what you behave like, you were a guard in a factory of death. And one of the ways they made that argument is they kind of introduced these really startling statistics as well. So I think for a lot of us, the paradigmatic example of a Nazi, a death camp, is someplace like Auschwitz. In Auschwitz, about 1.2 million people were deported to Auschwitz. Of those 1.2 million, about 100,000 survived. Now, if you think about Auschwitz then as a disease, that's an exceptionally lethal disease. I mean, that's a disease with over 90% death rate. And yet, Auschwitz was a hybrid camp. It was part slave labor camp, and it was part death camp. If you compare Auschwitz to the pure death camps that the SS created, Sobibor, Treblinka, and Belzec, of those three camps, you have 1.5 million, almost exclusively Jews, are sent to those three camps. There are exactly 125 survivors. And so they really sort of drove home the argument that it doesn't matter whether this guy was cruel or not. We know that he was a death camp guard. We know that the only purpose of this camp was to create corpses. And to the extent that he participated in that, it follows lockstep that he was an accessory to murder. And again, it was a very simple insight, but it was an insight that no court had reached in the 70 years of Holocaust trials. I think I'll stop right there and then open things up to your questions, because instead of droning on, I'm sure you have a lot of questions that will permit me to kind of expand on what I've said so far. Yes, please.
When he was accused and found guilty of being the accessory to the murder,
yes.
What about voluntarism?
Yeah.
The degree on which he volunteered
right.
to be part of that crime. Because yeah. if he was forced to be at that camp,
yeah.
if he had no other choice, if death was going to be his result,
right.
then he is not acting voluntarily.
Yeah.
How did the issue of his willfully and voluntarily being part of that camp contribute to his,
right.
His guilt?
And you are...
Bob,
yeah. So Bob, did everyone hear Bob's question?
Yeah.
Everyone will hear it. So Bob's question, in many ways, was the question of the trial. It really was the question of the trial. Now, in a certain way, the trial didn't necessarily grapple with the question in the way that I would have entirely liked, and that was largely because of the profile of Demjanjuk's defense. Remember, Demjanjuk, from the very outset, from when early 1970s, when American investigators first caught word that he might have been a death camp guard, he always insisted, I never did any of this. I was a POW until the end of the war. And that made for a very kind of tricky defense in Munich. Because it's hard, if we kind of stick with Bob's point, it's hard to make the following argument. It's hard to get up there and say, I was never at Sobibor. But if I had been there, I was there involuntarily, right? I mean, that's kind of it's sort of an incoherent argument to make. And so in a certain way, his defense foreclosed perhaps the best opportunity for him to launch a meaningful defense. Notwithstanding that fact, the prosecution was well aware of that issue, and they weren't gonna kind of leave it to the happenstance of the defense. So the prosecution very, very aggressively tried to argue that this guy was not there involuntarily, that this was a voluntary act of service. How did they do it? Well, one thing to mention is that if you look at the, I don't know how many of you have spent time in Germany. We've been spending, every summer we've been going back to Berlin, which is a city I absolutely adore. I really, really like Berlin. And in many ways, you know, Germany is done a very impressive job of confronting the legacy of the Holocaust. Really done a very impressive job. In fact, one story I often tell is that we were there a few years ago, and at the time our older son, I think he was 14 years old, and we're walking around Berlin, and I said to him, oh, what's that across the street? Let's go look at it. And he goes, Dad, it's just another monument to atrocity. And and so in many ways, you know, the Germans have been very impressive. The one area in which they weren't that impressive was in their trial programs. In their trial program, they did not necessarily amass a particularly impressive record of convicting people who participated in the Holocaust. One of the questions we have to ask is why? Why did they fail to convict? Because they did actually bring charges against a lot of people and even brought a decent number of people to trial. Unfortunately, a lot of these trials resulted in acquittals. Now, we might be scandalized by that, but one of the reasons that we find these acquittals, particularly in the 60s and the 70s, through the 80s, is exactly the point that Bob brings up. Defendants were able to kind of very successfully argue, okay, yeah, I engaged in all these horrific criminal acts, but I engaged in them under duress. I was forced to do them because if I hadn't participated in these genocidal acts, then I would have put myself in peril of life or limb. And it's very hard for a prosecutor to then, unless you have the historical evidence, to challenge that claim. You know, there is this notion in law of in dubio reo, you know, doubt goes to the defendant. And so in many cases, you know, if people made that argument, it often resulted in an acquittal. Well, as a result of this pattern of acquittals, a huge historical effort was devoted to trying to answer that question. The question of if a guard opted out of this exterminatory process, was he putting himself in peril of life and limb? And one question you might ask is, well, did people actually even opt out? Do we have a record of these things? And the answer is yes. There were people who opted out, maybe not as many as we might hope, but there were definitely people who opted out. What happened to them? One of the most astonishing, I think, things that historians have discovered was that of the people who opted out of the Nazi genocidal machine, the total number of people who put themselves in a peril of life or limb, that is, who really suffered draconian consequences from opting out, that number is exactly zero. There has never been a single documented case of someone receiving some kind of draconian punishment for opting out. And you should also bear in mind that the people who were really invested in finding that were the people who were defending SS officers. So they really engaged in a very aggressive effort to kind of enlist historians. They were never able to find a single case. Now, can I just stick with your question for one more moment? Because you could come back, Bob is going to come back and say to me, well, we're not talking about an SS guy. We're talking about someone who is Ukrainian who was taken as a prisoner of war. Maybe they were operating under different kinds of pressures. And again, you had these historians at the trial come forward and they say, let's be clear. These guys were no longer prisoners of war when they started training at Treniki. They were then very clearly workers, you know, co-workers with the SS. These guys who were armed, they're armed very often with automatic weapons. They drew sick leave. They even drew, you know, paid home leave. So they went home to Ukraine and came back and continued their service. If they died, if they were killed somehow in a camp, they would be buried with full military honors. And so there was a real categorical difference between the members of these Ukrainians like Demjanjuk and the Jewish prisoners. And again, it's a great question you ask because one of the things that his defense lawyer tried to do at the same time that he was trying to argue that, no, he never did anything, he did try to say that, well, people like Demjanjuk, he never said Demjanjuk, he had to say people like Demjanjuk, people like Demjanjuk were no different than the Jewish prisoners in the camp itself. Now, in the trial, that got a lot of people going, boo, boo. You know, the spectators and the journalists also were like, how tone deaf can you get? But it was the crucial question. It really was the crucial question. So it's an excellent question that you asked. Yeah. Yeah, there was first here and then, yeah.
So when you talk about three legal systems, the U.S., yeah, the German, and the Israeli, mm-hmm, how did this relate to any of the legal precedents that were established in Nuremberg? And that legal, that was international law,
right?
Right.
Yeah.
And it, you know, tried to come to grips with the idea of genocide and tried getting around a whole bunch of concepts that seemed related to this.
Yep.
And kind of why didn't it end up in that kind of tribunal, that kind of system?
Yeah, I always love the questions that come up only because I feel like they've been planted. And just like, you know, we've never seen each other before, right? We've had no communication at all, right? So at Nuremberg, the
question.
Oh, I'm sorry. The question was, why wasn't a case like the Demjanjuk case tried, let's say, before an international tribunal, or at least using kind of the kind of international law that was pioneered at Nuremberg? And the short answer for why there wasn't an international tribunal is that, I mean, that's a very short answer. The short answer is Nuremberg was what we call an ad hoc tribunal. So as soon as its remit was done, you know, like it was created in order to try these 21 major Nazi war criminals, and as soon as it was done in 1946, it disbanded. But the deeper question to ask is, what about international law? Because there is these kind of these incriminations that were pioneered at Nuremberg. So at Nuremberg is the first trial to use this incrimination called crimes against humanity. Very important development in international criminal law. Nuremberg doesn't use genocide, but by 1948, genocide is recognized as an independent crime with the Genocide Convention, UN Genocide Convention of 1948. And so you have a number of, let's say, if, for example, if you look at the Eichmann trial, Israel basically tries Eichmann under what looks more like international law than domestic law. Israel basically codifies the Genocide Convention into their own domestic law and tries Eichmann basically using a domestic variety of a genocide. If you look, for example, at some of the trials that took place in France, some of you might be familiar with the name like Klaus Barbie, the so-called Butcher of Lyon. The French do the exact same thing. They basically take the definition of crimes against humanity from Nuremberg, they incorporate it into their domestic code, and they basically try this guy as a perpetrator of crimes against humanity. For narrow technical reasons, using these kinds of international law incorporated into domestic law makes it a lot easier to convict these characters. I mean, they're just, because these incriminations, they're actually designed for this type of crime. Germany comes along and says, no, we can't use crimes against humanity or genocide to try any perpetrators of Holocaust-related crimes. We can't do it. And why not? Well, their argument is it would violate the bar against ex post facto law. Now, again, a lot of you are probably familiar with this notion. Is everyone familiar with this? Know what ex post facto? Ex post facto is basically the idea that it would be fundamentally unfair for me to try you for conduct which was not criminal at the time that you engaged in it. So because crimes against humanity was recognized in 1946, because genocide was recognized in 1948, the Germans conclude, well, we can't try people for that because it would be unfair, because they engaged in their crimes in the early 1940s. And again, you're smiling, and a lot of people were like, you gotta be kidding me. Really? In fact, in this book, I deal with this question not to exhaustive detail, but to thrilling detail, I think I would describe it. And exactly. It's still priced to move. And but I deal with exactly this question, that is how it is that, you know, why Germany reached this really, really problematic conclusion. And then and I'm not going to kind of go into it exactly right now, but a lot of it just had to do with the fact that the Germans in the early 50s really turned against the Allied war crimes trial program. And they really rejected it as, you're just kind of rubbing our face in the main crime that we committed, which was losing the war. And because they kind of really rejected the war crimes program, they rejected all the law that was associated with it, namely crimes against humanity and genocide. And they say, we don't want to have anything to do with those incriminations. Well, once you take those off the table, the question arose, like, what do we charge these people with? And the thing that the Germans did is they charged these perpetrators with simple murder, being either a murderer, that is, committing, being a perpetrator of murder or an accessory to murder. And that's the only thing they could charge them with. It's the only thing that was left on the table. Now, I kind of talk about this in the book as well. What this really meant then is you basically had to kind of shoehorn the Holocaust into a garden variety murder statute. And in prosecuting, you know, someone for garden variety murder, then it's back to the kind of thing we see in police dramas where you kind of, you need a witness, you need a motive, you need evidence. When you're dealing with a death camp, That's very hard to do. I mean, we were already talking about Sobibor, Treblinka, and Belzec. We have 125 survivors on the entire planet. So, you know, the very success of the exterminatory process made treating it like a simple act of murder almost impossible to get convictions. And that, again, was one of the kind of the crucial breakthroughs that happens in the Munich courtroom, that they basically come along and they say, look, we don't need to prove that he killed with his own hand. We don't need evidence that he kind of like beat someone to death. He was an facilitator of genocide. That was his job. That's all we need to prove. And again, it was a very simple conclusion, first court to realize that in, or first court to frame that conclusion in the 70 plus years of these kinds of trials. Yeah, yes.
Genocide museum, and I'm struck, I mean, this wasn't guards, this was people in positions of great authority who had wrist slaps. And I don't know, somehow I got the impression maybe the Cold War and maybe desire on the West Germans part to get some of these people who were very influential to side with them as opposed to Russians, that that was some factor in terms of this outcome. So
the question was, role that the Cold War might have played in explaining the fact why some real high-up architect, not these, someone I think we can all agree is that Demjanjuk is a pretty lowly figure in this exterminatory hierarchy. How is it that these, you know, pretty implicated figures ended up receiving relatively minor prison sentences? And just your name? Dave. So I think Dave's question goes a lot to some of these trials that were conducted by the U.S. military. Sometimes you might have heard about the Nuremberg trial, and then sometimes you hear about, with a plural, Nuremberg trials. And the Nuremberg trial was an international court that tried 21 of the leading Nazi war criminals, people like Goering and Hess and people like that. That's really the famous trial. The Americans then conducted several hundred trials in the same courtroom. They basically, it's like, hey, we renovated this courtroom in Nuremberg, let's use it again for our trials. And so they basically had trials that were conducted by American Military Commission. And they tried some pretty high up people and convicted, you know, a couple hundred very prominent Nazis. Of the couple hundred very prominent Nazis who were convicted by these Americans in these follow-up trials in Nuremberg, every single one of them was a free man by 1958. And the question is, why were they all freed by 1958? And the answer is, basically Dave supplied the answer to his own question. A lot of it has to do with the Cold War. It's very quickly, the United States decides that Germany is no longer our adversary. We already fought that war. We now have a new war, the Cold War, in which our former ally is now our adversary. And in order to secure Germany as a reliable ally in that Cold War, the Americans are basically prepared to commute the sentences of a lot of the people. And those commutations of sentences, I have to say, they create a lot of scandal domestically. You had the Senate Judiciary Committee. They had hearings to look into why it is that these, you know, very, very implicated Nazis are suddenly being commuted, why they're having their sentences commuted. There were many editorials. If you go back to the New York Times in the early 50s, many editorials kind of expressing outrage at this commutation policy. But the short answer is exactly as you suggested. It was an effort to secure Germany as a reliable ally and an awareness that Germany had very aggressively rejected these war crimes trials that the Americans had conducted and the other allies had conducted as well. Yeah. Yes. So the Russians, I mean, recall that the Russians are the ones who basically liberate all the death camps. So, you know, some of the concentration camps that we're familiar with, places like Dachau or Belsen in the West, I mean, those are really more concentration camps. They weren't death camps per se. All the death camps were basically in the East. In fact, they were all in kind of occupied Poland. And so they were all liberated by the Red Army. And the Red Army then got the hold of basically all the material from the basically the from Nazi genocide. They had the vast amount of material. And in fact, even before the collapse of the Soviet Union, when the United States was engaging in denaturalization and deportation of other suspects in the United States would basically have to, you know, this is our Cold War adversary, but we'd still have to try to work out some kind of cooperation with the Soviet Union to get evidence against these characters. And it was very difficult to do so. The Soviet Union was not particularly helpful with the United States, and these collaborations were kind of few and far between. So it really is not until the collapse of the Soviet Union that suddenly you get this vast amount of material. And in fact, just as a small historical observation, if you look at the number of deportation cases, denaturalization deportation cases in the United States, they kind of come along, you know, in the 1970s, a certain number, and then in the 1990s, they start to spike. They go up very dramatically, and it's because suddenly the Americans get access to all this information they hadn't been able to get access to for decades. There was just to get some other, yeah, and then.
The basis of the trial in the United States just recently, it's been in the newspaper. And what was the outcome from that?
The trial in the, are you talking about the trial in Germany that's going on right now? Because there is a trial that's going on right now in Germany of this guy named Reinhold Hanig, who was also a guard at Auschwitz. And there was also another case that was decided, and that's going on right now as I speak. And then there was also a case that was resolved that ended in conviction this past summer of someone named Oskar Grönig, who was the so-called bookkeeper of Auschwitz. And those are both trials that built exactly on the Demjanjuk precedent. That is one thing that German prosecutors did is that since they finally framed the right theory to try these guys, they finally went racing back and said, is there anyone else still alive that we can now use our new theory on? And certainly if you want to be cynical, you know, you can come along and say, well, isn't it ironic that the proper theory was only framed at a time when all the perpetrators had already died off? But nonetheless, I mean, you do have German prosecutors who, in a very good faith effort, are trying to, you know, apply this theory to the last remaining perpetrators and collaborators who they can, who are healthy enough to stand trial. Yeah. Yep. Yes.
Was anybody surprised that the communists had kept all these records? Because couldn't they have just destroyed them? I mean, obviously.
No, I don't think anyone was particularly surprised that they kept those documents. In fact, the Soviets conducted actually a lot of their own kind of war crimes trials after the war. They typically were trials for people who they were accusing of treason, of, you know, being treasonous to the motherland. But if you had collaborated with the SS and you were then captured by the Soviets, you were in big trouble. And so they were really interested in, you know, trying as many of these collaborators as possible. So they kept pretty elaborate records. And if you look at the records of these Soviet trials, it's also very bizarre, because I think we all have this image of these Stalinist show trials in which people are kind of forced to confess and the whole thing is kind of a farce. And in certain trials, you can say, oh, this was pretty much a farce. Then in other trials, you find these Soviet prosecutors engaging in a really good faith effort. You find these bizarre things like, oh, this guy was accused of killing 220 civilians in this mass grave in this one part of Ukraine. And yet when we sent our investigators to that mass grave, we could only find 198 bodies. Where are the other 30 bodies? We want to send them back and try to discover, you know, the missing bodies. And so you do find these really interesting cases in which the Soviet prosecutors are trying to be very, very, really, really assiduous. And of course, the other thing to bear in mind is, you know, again, if these were people who were enemies of the Soviet state, well, they're going to keep incredibly good records about them. In fact, you know, I've talked to American investigators who said that, oh, they were just stunned at the quality of the Soviet record keeping. You know, they really had like real archival science at its best in the age before computers. You were waiting.
What's the relationship to what you've been discussing, to the Hague
And the second question is, what kind of evidence is compelling for someone who's at the top who doesn't kill anyone? So I'm not killing him.
Right. Does everyone hear the question? So the question is, how does this kind of relate to things that are going on in The Hague? And the other question was, you know, what kind of, how would we go about prosecuting someone who was, let's say, the top of the hierarchy, you know, someone who's not doing any of the kind of hands-on killing, to use what the Germans called the Schreibtischmörder, which is, you know, the desk killer. You know, someone who's kind of sitting behind a desk picking up a phone. And so the first question with respect to the Hague. So the Hague is the house, this is where the permanent International Criminal Court is now housed. Some of you might be familiar with the fact that, so I had mentioned in answer to your question that that the Nuremberg trial was an ad hoc tribunal, so it basically ended in 1946. Basically, around 10 years ago, the international community said, well, instead of having these kind of ad hoc international criminal courts, why don't we establish a permanent criminal court that can try people for genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes? And that court is now up and running in The Hague. The problem with that court is, even though it has already 100 nations that have signed on to it, is there are few nations that are participating in it. And the few nations that aren't participating in it, the United States, China, Russia, India, Pakistan, Indonesia. So basically, you have, you know, by far the largest countries in the world and the most important countries in the world, they're not really participating in this court. So if there are, let's say, you know, war crimes committed between Norway and Sweden, there's a very efficacious tribunal that would be empowered to deal with that kind of thing. But the this International Criminal Court remains very much, I would say it's a work in progress. I mean, some of you might know that the United States had a really hostile relationship to this International Criminal Court during the Bush administration, during the Obama administration, that that relationship has thawed to an important degree, even though we remain officially not members of that court. So it is something which is still gaining its sea legs, I would say, that International Criminal Court. And the second question was dealing with the higher-ups. How do we, the higher-ups, and you do have trials. I mean, let's be clear that, you know, even if the story is not an entirely satisfactory one about perpetrators of the Holocaust being brought to justice, you do have a substantial number of trials at the end of the day, and you do have higher-ups who are tried. And they're very often tried based on their own documentary record. I mean, because this, again, is something where the, I think sometimes we almost have a little stereotype that the SS and the Nazis were incredibly good at keeping records. Sometimes that's not entirely true. Like, for example, in this Treniki camp, the record keeping was just scandalously bad. I mean, you know, for research, it's just like, I thought these were SS people. What happened to their record keeping? This is pathetic. But you know, certainly at the higher up, you had a decent number of records that would permit people to be, that facilitated trials. I would say in terms of the problems that prosecutors face, is they faced a lot more problems almost with the lower level people than they did with the higher ups. That said, well, I'll just leave it at that. I'll leave it at that, because there is a little asterisk I could give you. Yes, these, yeah.
The Soviets, they're just abusing disinformation.
Yeah.
To their benefit.
Right.
Clearly, Kurt Wall died. Yeah. Is a classic example.
Right.
He was a war criminal.
Yes.
They had all the documentation, yeah. And they withheld.
Right.
To use that to gain benefit.
Yes.
Their system clearly,
exactly.
They do have that. Perfect record.
Yeah.
That's how they kept people occupied.
Yes.
Keeping records.
Yes, exactly. No, I think that's right. And there were all sort of tactical and strategic reasons for why they withheld records. They were able to kind of exercise power over people, knowing that they had records that they could use against them. There obviously becomes a very powerful tool for recruiting KGB agents. You know, if someone knows that they've got a compromised past and the Soviets have this information on them, so absolutely, they used it for very tactical reasons and successfully. Yes?
A question, would you care to comment on any of the military trials conducted by the U.S. That did result in executions of low-level participants of Dachau, Auschwitz, and some of the other camps after the war? Not as famous as the Nuremberg trial, but also active at that time. And the second question is, do you think this has, this particular case and the logic used in it, does it have precedence for other countries, or just precedence in Germany, and for other atrocities and other than the Holocaust?
Yeah. Does everyone hear those questions? So again, the question was, I'll deal with the second question first, which was this precedent that was framed finally in this Demjanjuk case, does it have legs that go beyond its application just in Germany? Can it travel in a sense? And I think the answer to that is yes. And I think that it's actually participating, I think both the breakthrough, wasn't simply exclusively a result of developments within the German legal system. I think in a way it connects back to the question about The Hague. Some of the case law that has been going on in The Hague in a tribunal that was dealing with the Balkans, this International Criminal Tribunal for former Yugoslavia, they were developing a theory called joint criminal enterprise. And this joint criminal enterprise was a little bit like the theory that is used in the Demjanjuk case. So I do think what you find here is you kind of find, you know, what we can almost describe as these kind of cross-pollination of legal systems. That is, that international law starts to influence a domestic tribunal, and that domestic tribunal creates a precedent which then will be picked up by other international courts. So I do think there is a kind of a larger theory about how to deal with state-sponsored atrocity. So I don't think this is something that is limited to the Holocaust. It really is something about, it's a tool that will help prosecutors deal with this question of state-sponsored atrocity. And then the first question that you asked was, actually I'm just blanking on it, your first one was?
Was about the trials.
Oh, yeah, yes, right, exactly, right. So the Americans, as I mentioned, so the question is about these other trials that were conducted by the Americans in the post-war period. And so, as I mentioned, there were several trials, or a number of trials, with a lot of defendants that were conducted in Nuremberg itself. And then there were other trials that were conducted in places like at the Dachau concentration camp, that basically the United States used that as a place to try some other former Nazis. And I would say, just in terms of the quality of the justice dispensed, I'm sort of a defender of Nuremberg. I think Nuremberg really was very important, and I would defend it against arguments about victor's justice. I would also defend the quality of the justice that was conducted by the American military at Nuremberg in these so-called follow-up trials. If you look at the trials that were conducted in Dachau, not so good the record there. I would say that even though you have lots and lots of convictions, there you really sort of have an erosion of the quality of the justice that's being dispensed. Now again, there are all sorts of reasons why you can say why that was the case. I mean, this was directly on the heels of a war. You can say that it's better to have trials than just summary executions. So there are all sorts of ways in which I would try to place what happened in these Dachau trials in context, but I don't think they necessarily stand as exemplars of American justice. Yeah. Yes?
With respect to the people in the Middle East operating under the banner of ISIS and all the atrocities that they're committing, in the context of this cross-pollinization of this environment with respect to Hague and other institutions, Do you think these people have crossed a line by actually announcing they're an Islamic state and making themselves into a country, or is that have any impact on how that ultimately might interplay with this whole process?
Well, the fact that they've kind of announced themselves as a state, I mean, I suppose the question is, you know, is it possible to imagine that you could use some kind of international tribunal for the purposes of trying these kinds of terrorists? And the answer is, you could use an international tribunal whether or not they declare themselves as a state. That is, you don't necessarily have to be a state per se. It makes life maybe a little bit easy as a jurisdictional matter, but it's not necessary. That is, if you can show that this is an organization which is committing genocide, which is committing crimes against humanity, committing war crimes, there's no problem with using a international court for the purposes of trying to respond to the acts, the crimes that are being committed with, by an organization like that. You do need to show that they are systematic, that they're large scale in order to get an international court, but that's, I think, a pretty easy showing to make in the case of something like ISIL. Yeah. Yes?
This question is a little bit out of the context of the Nazis. Mm-hmm. Given the widespread criminality that occurred against Jews in other countries, which wasn't part of the Nazi death machinery, has there been any kind of prosecution of mass murderers in any of these other countries that was occurring? I mean, granted, in Lithuania and other places where they just lined up hundreds of people just shot them and put them in a grave. I mean, I'm just kind of curious, given that the Nazis did an amazing job with their machinery, there was a lot of other spontaneous mass persecution of Jews in other places.
Okay, so the question, so they're almost, and so one question is, you know, were there trials in other countries? And the answer is absolutely yes. I mean, there were thousands of people that were tried actually in Poland. There were thousands of people who were tried in the Netherlands. There were thousands of people who tried in France. So you have a lot of trials after the war. Now, a lot of these trials aren't necessarily what we would describe as, let's say, specifically of Holocaust. A lot of them have to do with treason. A lot of them have to do with collaborating with the enemy. But if you actually look at the kind of treasonous or collaborative activities that the people are engaging in, they're very often of an exterminatory nature. Now, the one area in which you focus in on is very interesting. You start talking about like Latvia and Lithuania, and there you don't find a whole lot. That is, you certainly don't find trials taking place after the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I think in those countries, a lot of people, it's a little bit also like with Austria as well, that these are countries that have for a pretty long time indulged in the myth of being the victims. And you know, because they were the victims, they don't really kind of see themselves as implicated in the criminality itself. And that issue that you raise about Lithuania, it's very interesting. Right now, that's a real hot topic within Lithuania that people are writing, you know, now trying to reckon with the fact that we never really came to terms with our participation in this exterminatory process, because there was a lot of complicity that had not really been reckoned with. Yeah. Yes?
I'm a speaker at the Midwest Center for Holocaust Education in mm-hmm. Kansas City mm-hmm. about my parents' experiences in pre-World War II Germany. And many years ago when I lived in Amherst, I was a mentor to a Cambodian student. And we were recently talking, and it seems to me as though centers like the one I speak at really should also include her.
I agree completely. I mean, did everyone hear the question? The question was whether centers that deal with, let's say, Holocaust testimony and Holocaust memory and Holocaust history, whether they should also include the experience of people who, let's say, survived genocide in Cambodia. And you know, I don't think that we should be in the business of going like, well, this is my genocide. This is my, you have your genocide. You go over there with your genocide. This is my genocide. So I'm very sympathetic to that. Yes, absolutely. And the experiences, and it is kind of, you know, we learn more by looking at the different forms that genocide has taken. And unfortunately, in the 20th century, you know, there were no shortage of examples of genocide. Yeah. Sure.
Why are you interested in this case instead of all the others?
So in this case as well, I already wrote a book about Eichmann and Nuremberg, so and Klaus Barbie. So I already got covered some of those. And you know, my original interest in this stuff is, I don't know if you're, you know, asking questions about personal biography or just you're not.
Apparently there's something special about this trial.
Well, this trial is, you know, as I tried to say, I mean, this trial was the last of these really high profile Holocaust trials. I mean, even, you know, some of the trial that's going right now, this Reinhold Hahn, I mean, that's basically kind of like a footnote to what took place at the Demjanjuk case. It really was the last one. And to the extent that my scholarly career has been, at least in part, spent like looking at Holocaust trials, I mean, in a sense, this was kind of the natural bookend. And since I happened to be living in Germany at the time that he was deported to Germany and was able to kind of arrange this thing with Harper's, it just became kind of like a goodie. I get to write about this important case. And as I said, you know, my attitudes about the case really did switch.
There is nothing unusual about this trial. Is that what you're saying?
No, he's
saying there's
no.
No.
It's the last trial, but that's sort of personal with you. Is there some?
No, I think I said that the trial was, I mean, it was unusual in all sorts of ways. As I said, it's the first trial that finally arrived at this theory of, that got to the heart of the idea of state-sponsored genocide. I mean, you have lots and lots of Holocaust trials, and you look at them, and very more often than not, the perpetrator is being presented as, oh, this guy was a monster. He was a monster who would eat his own grandmother. He was, you know, it was, again, it was kind of the stereotypical things that prosecutors would do, where they would basically say, you know, these guys are moral monsters, these are people who are sociopaths, these are, and this is, you know, one in which they said he wasn't, and that's why he's guilty. And the other thing is, you know, people could come along and say, oh, well, he was just a lowly functionary. Well, that's true. And the Holocaust would never have happened without the lowly foot soldiers in genocide. No genocide would take place without the lowly foot soldiers. If you think of genocide simply as a crime of, you know, the top members of a state, then that's a very misleading picture. And, you know, which is not to say that you shouldn't go after the heads of state, obviously you should, but genocide would not happen without the complicity of thousands of people. And, you know, this trial, when you read the book, you'll see that the trial has other very unusual features in it. One of the unusual things that happens in this Munich courtroom is, again, it's kind of the inverse of what happens in Israel. No one can identify the guy. There are only basically five Sobibor survivors left on the planet Earth at the time that he's tried. None of them can identify him. And what becomes very odd is, instead of using witnesses, it turns into what I call this trial by history. You have professional historians basically doing a lot of the work of the prosecution. Very unusual kind of a trial to see these professional historians kind of almost taking the place of eyewitnesses at the trial. Yeah, are we still good with time? I just don't. What? I mean, what? We're late. That's what I was. So I was told early on, just to let you know, that I was going to like get a cutoff sign, but I haven't seen the cutoff sign. So, are you giving me the cutoff sign? Okay. Well, thank you.